Welcome to Claws and Convo, episode 6, the MFF pre-show thing. I am your host and producer, Striker Chiwar. And for the, if this is your first time tuning in, this is the show where, of course, I don't know what the fuck I'm doing, but I do it anyway. The show is about conversations and just whatever the hell's going on. Well, it's just random. And this is one of those kind of shows where the audience is kind of part of the show. So, yeah, the Skype line will be open through the entire duration of the show. So if you want to call in, hang out, talk about anything at all, if you've got any subject in mind, feel free to call in. And the Skype handle is in the description of the stream below, and as always, you can go to clawsandconvo.strikepaw.com to get more information on the show, or email us, or do whatever. But yes, I mean me, because it's at the moment a one-man operation, one feline operation. So, Midwest Furfest is just around the corner. It's next week. And as I'm going to be there, there will be no show next week, but I'll be there at MFF. So we're doing a little show about MFF. So as I kind of try to get the background music, it's really difficult to produce and host at the same time. I've got all this other things going on. What am I looking for? Tiaran Psalm. Yeah, that's a rather typical. There's our background music. Nice, calm stuff. Okay. So anyway, right, and I'll actually have my first seat for MFF. But anyway, I digress. Midwest Furfest 2014 is held next week, 5th through the 7th, in Rosemont, Illinois, at the Regency O'Hare Hyatt. That's right next to the airport, and it's really a nice hotel. The guests of honor this year are going to be Lacey and Nick from firstshooting.com, Sabertooth Ermine, and D. Walker. Charity will be his Critter Camp Exotic Pets Sanctuary in German Valley, Illinois. And you can find more information about them specifically. About the guests of honor and the charity, of course, at furfest.org. I'll link that in the chat. I forgot to make that a complete link, but you can figure it out. Anyway, so yeah. Last year, it was decided that due to some scheduling conflicts and fast growth of the attendance, the Midwest Furfest staff decided it was just kind of a last minute deal, where they had to reschedule, so rather than continuing with November, they had to move the con to December, which really isn't ideal, but it was more or less the last minute change that was pushed by certain conflicts with the other things that were going on. Anyway. So, I'll be going there. I'll be getting there bright and early on Friday. And, really looking forward to it because I'm going to pick my fursuit, hopefully. And it'll be my first time in a fursuit, so it'll be really awesome. Super excited. But, normally this would be the part where we'd have news and stuff, but, as it has been the case, there's really not a lot going on. But, I do have... I was able to pull up something from last week, which I probably could have did on as I stumble upon my thoughts. Now, it's interesting the way my thoughts work. The way I think is kind of like, you know, if 30 people try to go through this through the same doorway at once. Yeah, that's kind of like... That's what my brain is like. Yeah, so... At least with something involving language. I don't know, it's weird. I have a thing. But, you know, I digress. But I was able to find this one little article on the Furry News Network, which is 1 week old. As I said, I could have done it last week, but I didn't. So, here we go. Wolfpack disrupts school, causes panic. Borough County, Georgia. Students will notice more security at Borough High School Wednesday after threats of a school shooting and complaints about a group of teens acting like wolves. Quote, "We've spoken to that group, the parents of that group. We have informed relatives to the rumors out there, and there is no validity to the information. There was any threat," end quote, says Ken Green with Borough County Schools. Video! There's a video. Play the video. Play, please play. You are not cooperating with me. There we go.
A metro town is talking about this group of high school students who spend their day dressed as wolves and howling in school hallways. School officials say rumors on social media and threats of a shooting forced some parents to keep their kids home today. Channel 2's Rachel Stockman is live tonight in Barrow County, and some students are telling you, Rachel, that maybe it's the howling kids who are the real victims here.
Jovita, I tell you, school officials and police are taking this very seriously, but they do not believe that there was any real threat here at this high school in Winder. However, they are talking to this group that some people call the Wolf Pack or the Harvest Moon Pack.
Students call them the Wolf Pack, and they say this is video of them at Winder Barrow High School howling. You can see some of them wearing tails.
It's basically this group of freshmen that kind of believe they were reincarnated from wolves in a past life, and they walk around wearing collars and like tails, and they howl at each other during class to get their attention.
Potentially inspired by programs like Twilight and Teen Wolf. Most students say the group is harmless, but panic spread Monday night.
The best way I would define it is pandemonium.
But it blew out of proportion because a bunch of people started like hating on them and making fun of them.
School officials say rumors started flying on social media of a school shooting this coming Friday.
We've spoken to that group, to the students involved, we've spoken to their parents, and there is no validity and no information to suggest that there was ever any threat.
But still, some parents pulled their children out of school, like this student.
Some parents are making their kids stay home just because, like, you know, out of fear or whatever.
And now school officials are beefing up security.
I think they're completely harmless. It's their own little group. I think that they're actually being victimized more than anything else here.
At this point, we don't know if any of the students have been disciplined, but we are told that the group that has been howling in school has been told to stop doing that. Reporting live in Barrow County, Rachel Stockman, Channel 2 Action News Nightbeat.
Rachel, now you mentioned more security there at the school. Are school officials taking any other steps to try to calm this down?
Jovita, exactly. They are expected to have some more school resource officers here tomorrow, and I'm also told by parents that they sent out robocalls telling parents that there was no threat.
All right. Thank you, Rachel, in Barrow County tonight.
Yeah, that's an interesting little news thing that I found. But don't really know what to say about that. It's kind of an oddity. But, you know, things, you know. It's high school. I'll put that link in the chat for... for you, and, yeah. So, yeah, that's about, let's finish all the news we've got for today. But, I'll continue playing the background music here. Pushing buttons. There we go. So, yeah. So I'll just go ahead and go into the Midwest Furfest a little bit more in depth. So, guests of honor, Lacey and Nick of fursuiting.com. Fursuiting.com is owned and operated by Lacey and Nick, a husband and wife team based in the Orlando, Florida area. Combined, they have well over a decade of experience as professional fursuit makers. Lacey and Nick officially teamed up in 2007 with the goal to offer exceptional quality, highly customized fursuits. Lacey originally began building costumes as a hobbyist in around 2003. When what started as a hobby quickly turned into a full-time job once she completed her Bachelor of Arts degree in 2007 and met her eventual husband and partner in fursuit building. Even after 7 years of fursuit.com together, they still enjoy the creativity and inspiration that comes from building fursuits full-time. Sabretooth Ermine. Sabretooth Ermine, Ermine for short, has been a furry her whole life, though of course she didn't know it most of the time. From what she could... from the time she could hold a pencil, she has been happily drawing cartoon animals and fantasy creatures at every opportunity. At the age of 16, she found the online furry fandom, began posting her own furry art, and after a short while, started taking commissions. Ermine loves her friendly furry community, the boundless creativity within it, and of course all the wonderful artwork. She has now been doing furry art as her full-time job for 8 years, but despite that, art is still her main hobby and passion too, and probably always will be. Ermine is happily married and lives in the beautiful British Columbia. She loves romping on the beach, Terry Pratchett, dancing to drum and bass, fountain food and drink, BBC nature documentaries, and hilltops on really windy days. That sounds like a singles ad. D. Walker/Kissel/Novadog has been into the furry since 1997, when he stumbled upon VCL Villian Central Library, an early furry art archive. From there, his interest in furry fandom paralleled his interest in urban art. Then some. Well, you're an awesome place in there. From there, his interest in furry fandom paralleled his interest in urban art, and then some. While he spent most of his time painting around the neighborhood, he was fascinated with creating his own versions of anthropomorphic characters, which evolved into an obsession to create characters for his own short stories and comics. D. Walker has been going to cons since about 2003 and finding more friends and people with similar interests in how furry art has influenced what he does creatively as well. Fast forward some years later, and he is now co-creator with G. McCloud of DAGS. They spend almost every day talking new ideas and scripts for a comic they hope one day to see as an animated cartoon. DAGS, it was DAGS. Now for the Midwest Furfest charity. Midwest Furfest is pleased to welcome Critter Camp Exotic Pet Sanctuary of German Valley, Illinois, as our charity for 2014. Over the past 10 years, Critter Camp has saved over 1,200 exotic animals of 36 species from across the United States. Most shelters aren't able to accommodate animals other than dogs and cats, so Critter Camp fills the great need and underserved need. Critter Camp currently provides a forever home for over 300 rabbits, ferrets, guinea pigs, foxes, rodents, birds, reptiles, and other exotic pets that are unable to find a home due to health, temperamental, or other special needs. They provide information to pet owners and the general public on the challenges of exotic pet care to help keep those animals from becoming homeless or euthanized. We are delighted to be able to help Critter Camp in their important work, and we know that you will enjoy meeting them and some of their changes. Critter Camp is licensed 501c3, non-profit, volunteer, no-kill shelter for exotic pets, and is on the web at www.crittercamp.org and on Facebook at www.facebook.com/CritterCamp. Please join us in welcoming them. Let's go into the programming, because I know those of you who are planning to attend are curious. So, let's quickly skim over this. Full screen. Okay, so Registration opens up at Thursday at 6 p.m. Followed by Thursday night BYOG. Calls this open gaming. Bring your own game, I assume it means. And Confeed will also be open. Friday, I will be arriving around 6 or 7 a.m. along with Yerka and Fox Art and who else? Anyway, I'll be there around 6 or 7 a.m. So if you find, if you're there and you know, find me, Minmo, find me. But I digress. 9 a.m. Con Suite will be open, and yeah, I'm actually pretty glad they're opening. They're opening up Con Suite rather early this year. It looks like 9 a.m. as opposed to slightly later, and I think they opened it later in previous years. But yeah, that's good and early. Excellent. Supposedly better for Friday. Anyway, I digress. 10 a.m. registration is open, along with tabletop gaming. 12 p.m. opening ceremonies. At 1 o'clock, Artist Alley and Dealer's Gym open up, along with the secondary gaming room. 2 p.m., meet the guests of honor for a hockey game and video gaming. 3 p.m., your first furry convention. Definitely something I recommend if this is your first convention, or if you just love listening to Kage. That is, of course, hosted by Uncle Kage. As well as fursuit roundtable and fursuit safety 101. This is going to leave me torn, as it is my first time in suit. I may go to fursuit safety 101. Maybe. I don't know. I'll have to see where I end up. Anyway, 4 p.m. How to draw animals. Fursuiting Business 101, a history of avians. Meet the charity and fursuit photo shoot. 5 p.m. Crowdfunding. Explaining furry to your parents. Shiny sponsor reception. A VS rehearsal. An MFF poker tournament. 6 p.m. Saw you want to sell in the Artist Alley. Canine meet and greet. Free psychology. That might be an interesting one. YouTubaloo and the three Huna fursuits. It's a mouthful. Advanced fursuit head and body techniques. Furry hams. Two rooms and a boom. And spiritual round table. Spirituality round table. 7 p.m. Intro to puppeteering. Intro to fursuit performance. Probably a good one for me to attend. Kage Story Hour. Discussions with Doc. Fursuit dance competition. Prelims. Ferocicon. I just happened to come out in just the right tone for Ferocicon. How to play in beginner's tournament. I did not mean to say it in such a tone, but it worked out so very nicely. 8 p.m. Science, Technology, and Medicine meet and greet. Kickstarting your brilliant plan. To the Ranting Griffin. Love his stuff. Vapecast Live, comedy from Canada. How do you say that? I don't know. Sketch jam. Right. 9 p.m. Comparative anatomy. Guided meditation. I'm getting into this. I don't know why. 9:30. Fem versus fancy shoot. I may be getting too into this. Possibly. 10 p.m. Puppy Roleplay 101. Pursuit Charades. Karaoke. Lapis and Tabula. Friday Dance. Advanced Lupus in Tabula. Cards Against Humanity. Cards Against Humanity. Always a good time. 11 p.m. Pursuit Charades. After Dark. After Dark. Ooh. Saturday, December 6th. Come on, sweet opens at 9 a.m. 10 a.m. Avians Roundtable. Tips of the Road. Fursuit Cleaning and Care. Another one that I should probably attend. Basic Fursuit Construction. FVS Rehearsal Number 2. Registration opens. Artist Alley opens. Dealers Inn opens. MFF Poker Tournament. Secondary Gaming. Tabletop Gaming. Open. 10:30 a.m. Sponsors Brunch. 11 a.m. Effective Writing. Rare Candy for Writers. Save the Cat Beat. What? A new introduction to puppeteering. Quitting the fandom. I quit. Yeah. A satirical representation on quitting the fandom. No, but seriously. That would be good. That looks like a good one to attend. The Power of Dreams. Fursuit photo shoot. 12 p.m. 3D modeling for beginners. 1 p.m. Fursuit parade staging. Video gaming. 1:30 p.m. Fursuit parade. 2 p.m. readings, short fiction, ref sheet 101, and depression sucks. Fursuiting that. Okay, 2:30 p.m. I lost my train of thought again. There it goes off the rails. I'm just watching the crash from the short distance. 2:30 p.m. Fursuit.com official photo shoot. Charity auction. 3 o'clock p.m. Why furry when anthros matter? Comedy Basics. Monday Buffett Show. One cast member's retrospectorial. Ingress 101. Logic versus Spirit. Logic. I digress. 3:30 p.m. Floor Wars Dance Battle. 4 p.m. Drawing Larger Ladies. Necessity. DTD Construction. Too much light makes the baby go blind. And Writing 101. The Basics of Story Crafting. 4:30 p.m. Charting Paradise. A story of self-discovery. Interesting. 5 p.m. Equine Meetup. Charity Presentation Critter Camp. Shamanism. 5:30 p.m. Improv and Life on Stage. The Neo-Fursuitist. 6 p.m. The Dragon Show Live. VG Trivia Quest. epic challenge. Much ado about mucking. This is at 7 p.m. Wrestling with Furs podcast live. Furry variety show. Smackdown. Scapegoats. Zombie makeup. Mega panel. FurOceanCon. How to play and beginners tournament. In case you missed the last. Eight o'clock p.m. Convention Horror Stories. What's that hosted by? Creators and Demons of the Night Meetup. Game building for fun and profit. And transfers. Castle Live. 8:30 p.m. 9:30 p.m. Three-headed monster. Life drawings. Comparative anatomy. 18 plus. 9:30 p.m. The Valdai Fox Music Show. 10 p.m. Game developers in the Fur Phantom. Whose Lion Is It Anyway? One Night Werewolf. Saturday Dance. Cards Against Humanity. Lupus in Tabula. 11 p.m. Kage Together. A charity performance. Uncle Kage and To the Nightingale Griffin on stage. Together. Epic. Also, meet furry game designers. 11:30 p.m. Midnight Ho! I hope I'm not clipping too much. I'm gonna tune that down a little bit so I'm not exploding your head with my voice as so powerful. Sunday at 9 a.m. Cons we will open. 10 a.m. Fursuit Jersey photo shoot. Suiting outside the fandom. Tools of the Trade. Super Hypnotic Journey. The Christmas and the Pagans. The Christians and the Pagans. Art Auction. Registration. Will open. Will the MFF Poker Tournament. Artist Alley. Deals in. Secondary Gaming. And Tabletop Gaming. 11 o'clock a.m. Pitching to publishers. Fitness, Nutrition, and Health 101. Fine Furs. Furry TV commercials. Getting into the entertainment industry. Improv. Profit. Do's and don'ts. How to be a handler. Midwest Furry Fandom Incorporated. Board of Directors meeting. That's who runs this thing. Fursuit photo shoot. 12 p.m. Video gaming. 1 p.m. A little furry leisure literature. Furry literature is where you find it. Biology discussion. Geocaching. Assassin's Creed enthusiast. CompuFur. A furry hackathon. Fursuit dance competition. 2 p.m. Protecting your IP. Theranthropy. 3 p.m. Furry Theory. Screening of Kaze, Winds of Change, Episode 1, Born of Fire, and the world premiere of Episode 2. Oh, that's exciting! Played Episode 1 of Kaze, Winds of Change on the show. Well, at least part of it in an early episode. Didn't play the whole thing because of spoilers. Also at 3 p.m., Fursuit Games. 4 p.m., Product Demo. Scrivener. What the hell is this? It's software. Huh. Careers with Enwolf. And finally, closing ceremonies at 5 p.m., then attend the Dead Dog Dance. Yes. So, yes, that is. That concludes the scheduling, the programming for this year's Midwest Furfest. which, again, is available at furfest.org. So, there you have it. Now I'll take a little bit of a break. And I'll be right back. But first, one video to be played from Camo Rovac, the real Five Nights Truth.
Move over, Map Hat, because a new theorist is in town. I'm going to take your Five Nights at Freddy's theory and turn it upside down. Internet, welcome to Camo's Game Theory, the show where I completely rip off a YouTuber that's much more successful than me. Now, if you've seen my Tumblr recently, you know I've been completely obsessed over Five Nights at Freddy's. I've always been a fan of horror stories like SCP, but man, this game has really struck a chord for me. I'm pretty sure it's because I was deathly afraid of animatronics when I was a kid. My first reaction to Five Nights was me joking about how Mike, the security guard, would have been safe if he had been wearing a mascot costume in the game. This will become relevant later, but now let's talk about one of my first series that has to deal with Golden Freddy. In the original Five Nights, Golden Freddy is a lot different compared to the other animatronics. He appears in your office after viewing the Golden Freddy poster. There are a few reasons why Golden Freddy is just a hallucination, but I want to point out something else. Golden Freddy is the only animatronic you see without an endoskeleton, which is why you see him all slouched on the ground, and you never actually see him move, even when he attacks you. If we read the posters about the missing children incident, we see that the killer was dressed in a mascot costume to lure the children. So it got me thinking, what if the Golden Freddy we see is just a hallucination of the costume the killer used? Now with Five Nights at Freddy's 2, my Golden Freddy theory seems right. On night 6, Phone Guy says,
"Someone used one of the suits. We had a spare in the back, a yellow one. Someone used it. Now none of them are acting right."
So solid theory, right? Well, let me go one step further. Remember my little joke when Five Nights first came out? In the second game, Jeremy has the ability to put on a Freddy mask to keep him safe from most of the animatronics. The second game is also a prequel to the first game because reasons. So why is Jeremy able to use a Freddy mask but Mike cannot? My guess is because the missing children incident from the first game didn't happen until after the second game in the story timeline. After the missing children incident, the Fazbear CEO decided not to give Mike or any other security guard a Freddy mask because the killer used a Golden Freddy costume. The Fazbear CEO wanted to avoid another incident. But there are a couple holes in my Golden Freddy theory. If we listen to what Phone Guy says in the second game on night 3 through 6, it really seems like the missing children incident was happening during the game. But the missing children incident could not have happened during the second game. If we go back to the posters from the first game, it says the incident started on June 26th of some year. The second game happens in November. A lot of people say that the Bite of 87 happens right at the end of Five Nights at Freddy's 2, with Jeremy being the victim. But how would a Golden Freddy suit be involved in the Bite of 87? Actually, hold on to that thought. Let's talk about the death minigames. When you die in the second game, you sometimes play a minigame where you play as an animatronic. There are 4 games in total, and I think they're past memories of the animatronics. Let's break each of them down, starting with the cake one. I personally think this is the oldest memory, and it takes place at Fredbear's family diner. You're serving cake to a bunch of kids. But while you're doing this, you see a kid crying outside. This kid is probably an orphan and is too poor to come inside to have cake. Then a car drives up, a person gets out and kills the kid. At the same time, you're hearing "Save him" being spelled out. Your movement slows down, making you unable to serve cake to all the children. Freddy knows what happens to the kid outside. He knows the guy murdered the child. At the very end, we see the jump scare animation of the puppet, which makes people think that the murdered orphan soul possesses the puppet. There's another minigame where you play as Foxy. You start in Pirate Cove waiting for a cue for you to run out and greet a group of kids to make them happy. You do this a couple times like normal, but then on the third time you see the same guy from the cake minigame standing outside Pirate Cove. When you run out into the other room, you see five dead children. The minigame ends with Foxy's jump scare animation. These two minigames show how the animatronics have observed how cruel people are to kids. I don't want to jump ahead too much, but remember what Phone Guy said on night four?
But the characters have been acting very unusual, almost aggressive towards the staff. They interact with the kids just fine, but when they encounter an adult, they just stare.
Then there's a Give Gifts, Give Life minigame, which tells a lot of story. You're playing as the puppet in a room with four dead children. At the top of the screen, it says Give Gifts. You walk up to each of them giving gifts. Once each dead child is given a gift, the instructions say Give Life. When you walk up to each of them, they change into the four animatronics from the first game. As you're doing all this, you hear Help Them being spelled as you play through. Once the last child is turned into an animatronic, a fifth body is briefly seen at the center of the room, followed by the animation for Golden Freddy's jump scare. In the last minigame, you play as Freddy in the restaurant from the second game. You see the puppet and you can go follow it, or you can go explore. As you play, you hear Save Them being spelled out. You'll find other animatronics, some dead bodies, and even Golden Freddy at random. Though, side note, it seems that Golden Freddy is also a hallucination because he disappears every time you touch him. The minigame ends when you follow the puppet to the prize corner and touch the dead body next to the puppet's box. There is an alternate ending to this minigame. As you follow the puppet, a purple man will appear in the room you just entered. The man will follow you until he comes into contact with you. Then the screen goes to static with the words "you can't" shown at the bottom. Some people think this guy is a phone guy because he wears a badge and is holding something that looks like a phone. But guys, that can't be a phone. Cordless phones didn't exist until 1994. So the minigames tell us a lot of things. First off, it seems like there's more than just a bite of 87 and the missing children incident. We see that more than 5 kids are being killed, and the animatronics are witnessing this. They know that people can be bad. Remember what Phone Guy says on night 4? He even said on night 1,
they're all tied into some kind of criminal database so they can detect a predator a mile away. Heck, we should be paying them to guard you.
This anti-criminal programming, combined with being haunted by child spirits, the animatronics are not bad. They're just trying to protect the children from adults. And for all the children that get killed, the animatronics try to help them by letting their souls live on as animatronics. My theory is that the animatronics are the good guys. It doesn't matter if Mike, Jeremy, or Phone Guy is innocent or guilty of murder. The animatronics see all adults as bad. They're just trying to protect innocent children. There's one last thing I want to talk about. The cutscenes from the second game. After every night, you're on the show stage from the first game looking through Freddy's eyes. At first it starts out normal, but as the nights progress, Bonnie and Chica turn to look at you closer and closer. Golden Freddy even makes an appearance in the cutscene after night 3. And after night 4, the puppet makes a very creepy appearance in a cutscene. He's just there, in your face, following you as you turn your head. You know what this means? Even though the toy versions of the animatronics are dismantled at the end of the second game, the puppet is still around during the events of the first game. But hey, that's just a theory. A game theory! See you in Five Nights at Freddy's 3. Move over, Map Hat, because a new theorist is in town.
I have no idea what the fuck I'm doing. So, Until next time, I've been your host and producer, Striker Chiguar. And Claws and Convo dot strikepaw.com, blah blah blah. Tune in. It won't be a show next Friday. Not next week. Because I won't be here. I'll be away next week to MFF. But the week after that, on the 13th, I will return. On the 12th, Friday the 12th, December 12th, Claws and Convo will return. So, yeah, anyway, thanks for watching. I've been Striker Chiguar. Clawsandconvo.strikepaw.com. Follow us on Twitter and YouTube, Strikepaw Studios. And until next time, rock hard, live free, keep it true. I'll see ya.